Thank you. Thank you. Good morning. Welcome to Arlington Street Church, gathered in love, in love and service for justice and peace. Welcome to the soul of Sunday. We are Unitarian Universalists. Ours is a historic faith with a progressive theology. We affirm the worth and dignity of every being, and that we are all deeply interconnected. We are bound to one another, not by creed, but by covenant, and we are called to love with open minds, open hearts, and open hands. Whoever you are, those of all nations, all creeds, all colors, all kinds of love, you are welcome here. Last week, Reverend Kim reminded us that last week was the 3-year anniversary of the lockdown, of the first Sunday that we did not meet in person. Tomorrow marks the 3rd anniversary of the first death to COVID in our state, and we know there were so many lost to COVID after that first. People we know and love, people in our own community. 3 years later, life looks different, and we all carry so much from the 3 years we've lived through. As I light our chalice, I'd like to share pandemic blessings, echoes from 3 years of living through the COVID-19 pandemic. Blessed are you who have died in these last 3 years and never saw life beyond the pandemic. Your histories are so much richer than this unprecedented time. Blessed are you whose physical symptoms have outlived your virus, you who are forced into a marathon. We will not get tired of you or for you as you stay the long course. Blessed are you who have been infected and have physically healed. Blessed is your recovery. Blessed are you who have not been infected, you who worry about what will be. Blessed is your unknown. Blessed be your health. Blessed are you whose care has been changed or delayed. Blessed be your anger. Blessed be your frustration. Blessed be your healing. Blessed are you who have missed milestones. You who marry, you who bear children, you who graduate, you who mourn, you who celebrate. Blessed are your milestones, and blessed be what is changed and what is lost. Blessed are you who are children. Blessed are you who grow up in times of fear and in times of conflict. Bless the wounds that have been inflicted so early. Bless your learning, bless your growing, bless and illuminate your future. Blessed are you who are physically or emotionally at risk. Bless your vulnerabilities and your exhaustion. Bless the hypervigilance you are forced to have, and bless your lives with patience, understanding, and protection. Blessed are you who have found healing for your mental health injuries. Bless your injuries, bless your memories, bless your efforts, bless your healing. Blessed are you whose mental health is inflamed. Bless you who live in fear. Bless you who cannot find hope. Bless your searching, bless your agony, bless your darkness. Bless you, hold on. Blessed are you who have returned, who are returning. Bless your persistence. Blessed are you who build anew. Bless you who imagine better, who plan for better. Bless your hope. Blessed are you who have helped. Bless your compassion. Blessed are you who have been helped. Bless your courage. And blessed are you who are living now. Blessed are you who are surviving now. Bless you, bless us.
Here together in this home.
As we gather today, we acknowledge that Arlington Street Church occupies the ancestral homeland of the Massachusett. By making this land acknowledgement, we recognize, honor, and affirm the sovereignty of all First Nation peoples. Welcome to our Zoomers, and welcome to the congregation gathered here in the sanctuary. Reverend Kim is in the Grand Canyon today. I'm Reverend Allie Jablonski. I'm the spiritual care director at Tufts Medical Center and an affiliated minister here at Arlington Street. Special thanks to our volunteers in the sanctuary today. Tech team, Great Doors team, greeters and ushers, worship team, musicians, and the Arlington Street Choir, directed by Mark David Buckles. Following the guidance of the Boston Public Health Commission, we are continuing to mask and physically distance in the sanctuary. Please keep your mask over your nose and mouth the whole time you're inside to protect our most vulnerable spiritual companions. Thank you. For those who are new to Arlington Street, a very special welcome to you. For those of you in the sanctuary, there are welcome cards in the pew racks. Please hand yours to an usher or drop it in the basket at the great doors as you leave. For those of you in the Zoom room, please fill out a connection card. The link is in the chat. It includes the option to request the link to a recording of today's sermon. Since they aren't here to greet you today, Reverend Kim and Reverend Beth would love to follow up with a virtual hello. Whether you've been coming here for years or today is your first time at Arlington Street, welcome home.
Good morning. If you haven't already downloaded today's order of service, it's available in the chat and on the homepage at ascboston.org. For our guests here in the sanctuary, there are printed copies at the great doors. As we begin our greetings, I invite the Zoomers and those in the sanctuary with a device handy to please say hello in the chat and tell us where you're zooming in from today. And now, Rich is going to turn the camera on the incarnate congregation as we wave and smize at each other, as well as our friends in the Zoom room. And you all in the Zoom room can wave and smile back. Hello, friends. Our opening hymn today is number 347 in the gray hymnal and in the chat. Let's rise in body, rise in spirit, and sing together number 347. Thank you. It is now time for our treasured ritual of sharing community candles of sorrow and joy. These candles were submitted on our website by the Friday evening deadline. If you didn't submit your candle and have a joy or sorrow to share this morning, please wait until the third candle is lit, the silent candle, and then type your joy or sorrow in the chat. Zoomers are invited to light silent candles at home. Those in the sanctuary are invited to light a silent candle at the table up front to the right of the Gleason podium. In addition to sharing our sorrows and joys this morning, let's reach out to one another in the week ahead, staying connected. May these times remind us of how very precious this beloved community is. We need one another. Whether together or apart, may we stay very close. And now, in the spirit of invocation, let's join in singing Sanctuary. The words are printed in your order of service and in the chat.
Us come today with heavy hearts. We open our hearts to you.
A candle of sorrow from the Arlington Street Church community as we acknowledge the passing of Bishop Frank T. Griswold III. As the primate and pastor of the Episcopal Church in America, he defied a threatened schism in 2003 by presiding in a bulletproof vest at the ordination of the denomination's first openly gay bishop, V. Jean Robinson, in the Diocese of New Hampshire. Both Bishop Robinson and his partner also wore bulletproof vests due to death threats. At the ceremony, Bishop Griswold said, "As Anglicans, we're learning to live the mystery of communion at a much deeper level." As a young priest in 1976, he helped revise the Book of Common Prayer, the church's main text for the first time since the Protestant Reformation in the 16th century. Bishop Griswold also supported the ordination of women. When he took over the Chicago Diocese in 1987, there were no women clergy. When he left 11 years later to become presiding bishop, 41 of the 146 priests in the diocese were women. After he retired in 2006, he was succeeded by Bishop Catherine Jeffords Shorey, the first woman to become a primate in the Anglican Convention. He later taught in seminaries and universities around the world while authoring several books. Bishop Frank T. Griswold III, presente. And our final candle is a mixed one from Keith Perrin. This is a candle of sorrow. Due to bigotry, fear, and hate, the Tennessee legislature passed and their governor signed into law an anti-drag law that goes into effect on April 1st. This is also a candle of joy for people like Bella Duval for continuing the fight to maintain rights for everyone, and NPR's Terry Gross for interviewing Bella and making this a topic of discussion.
Thank you.
some of us come today in joy. We share your joy.
Our sole candle of joy today is from the Arlington Street Church community as we celebrate the first day of spring on March 20th. Astronomical spring officially begins with the vernal equinox tomorrow at 5:24 p.m. We couldn't agree more than with poet Gerard Manley Hopkins, who said, "Nothing is as beautiful as spring." Happy spring, everyone.
All the sorrows and all the joys we hold in our hearts, we light a silent candle to remember and to rejoice. May the peace of this sanctuary enter into our hearts as we share a quiet moment together, breathing our prayers for ourselves, for one another, for our country, and for the world. Amen.
Let's join now in saying together the affirmation and covenant of this beloved spiritual community. The words are printed in your order of service and in your chat. Love is the spirit of this congregation, and service is our gift. This is our great covenant, to dwell together in peace, to speak our truths in love, and to help one another.
El amor es el espíritu de nuestra congregación, y el servicio es nuestro regalo. Esto es a lo que nos comprometemos, convivir en paz, hablar nuestras verdades con amor y ayudarnos los unos a los otros. Please rise in body or spirit and join in singing hymn number 12, O Life That Maketh All Things New. The words can be found in your order of service and in the chat. Thank you. I often share stories from my work as a chaplain. To protect the identity of those I work with and work beside, I change all the identifying details, but keep the essence of what happened. I've done this for the stories that I'm going to share with you today. Please come right away. Patient cannot stop panicking. This was the page verbatim. I got late one evening, and as I ran to the ICU, I imagined all of the reasons my patient could be panicking. There are so many when you're in the hospital. When I got there, I asked her nurse why our patient was panicking. "No clue," John said. "We are hoping you can figure it out." I introduced myself to the patient that I'll call Margaret, who was gripping the hospital bed as tight as she could. I sat down beside Margaret and gently asked her what she was thinking about. We just sat there for a long time before Margaret looked at me with eyes full of fear and said, "I'm really not supposed to talk about this. You'll think I'm a monster." I let Margaret know that I would follow her lead and that I have never thought a person was a monster. Margaret shook before saying, "I know I shouldn't tell people about the past, but I can't block it from my mind. The last time I was in the hospital, I caused someone's death. You'll hate me. Everyone here will hate me." Slowly, at Margaret's pace, I learned about how, after working a long shift while in school, Margaret gave a coworker a ride home and fell asleep at the wheel. Her friend died, and Margaret was hospitalized for months. She could not experience this hospitalization without thinking about that hospitalization. These are some of the popular phrases that come up in a search of sayings about the past. You can never plan the future by the past. Let go, let God. The past has no power over the present moment. Stop being a prisoner of the past. These sayings show a breakup with the past, an escape from the past, a clean cut, aspirations of running away and not looking back. Maybe there are times when this works. But so often, despite the very popular sayings and teachings, it does not work to completely separate from our past. Sometimes, instead of breaking away, sometimes we need to return. and not just to return, but to return with love. The two options often presented to us about the past are being stuck in the past or moving beyond the past and not being affected by it anymore. But there is so much that exists between the all and the nothing. Very little in life is a clean cut. We are connected to the past in complex ways. If past experiences bring present feelings of pain, I offer a gentle invitation of returning to the past with love. So often in moments of pain, we aren't able to show ourselves love. We aren't able to find the helpers. We have shame, and the shame pushes us to run. And shame can breed crippling loneliness. Sometimes returning with love is about returning with compassion. Let's return to Margaret, who had been told by loved ones to never tell new people she meets about the accident so many years ago. Margaret was in the hospital for a few weeks, and we met many times. Margaret told me that even if she doesn't talk about it, she thinks about the accident all the time. She had loving family members and friends, and no one from that time in her life ever talked about what happened. I would give anything to have gotten more sleep, to have done things differently, to not have worked so many shifts, Margaret said. I asked Margaret if anyone had shown her kindness when she expressed her pain. And she said that she had kind people in her life, but because they never talked about the accident, there wasn't really a chance for kindness. Margaret and I talked about her Christian faith and how she had always loved the ritual of lighting candles in churches for prayer intentions. I asked Margaret what it would feel like to light a candle for her past self who was driving when the accident happened, for her past self who was hospitalized for months, and for her past self who couldn't talk about her pain. Margaret and I started turning on an electric candle every time we talked about this time in her life. And when we lit the candle, we named intentions we had for Margaret. Over time, Margaret's intentions came to include love and patience. Margaret was able to discharge from the hospital, and she tells me that when she thinks of the accident, she still lights candles, this time real candles in the safety of her home. Sometimes returning with love is about returning to an experience of pain and creating something new. A patient I'll call Miguel had been in the hospital for many weeks before he moved to the ICU. Miguel's intake chart noted not religious. When I introduced myself to Miguel, he did what I think of as spirit fingers and said, "I'm gay." "Me too," I said. He just looked at me for a while. And he said, "So you're a chaplain?" Then he said, "Are you gonna bless me with some ashes, chaplain?" I smiled and told him that even though it wasn't Ash Wednesday, I could probably find some ashes if that's really what he wanted. Following my instinct, I said, "But I'd prefer to bless you with glitter." Miguel smiled and said, "Cover me in glitter." Miguel was hospitalized for many months. Over time, I learned about how Miguel felt ostracized by his church and how he felt he couldn't be spiritual as a gay man. He missed the rituals he had loved as a child, including Ash Wednesday. I told Miguel about why I had thought about a glitter blessing so many months before. I told Miguel about my first Ash Wednesday at Divinity School and how the queer theology group did a glitter blessing. They explained that this was a new offering to many who had felt kept out of Christian practices, and that the marking of glitter on our foreheads was meant to show God's unconditional love for us exactly as God made us, an unconditional love that would last always. I remember seeing many of my classmates attend the glitter blessing, some with bare foreheads and some with ashes on their foreheads, the glitter bringing sparkle to the ash. Miguel loved hearing about this ritual and talked about the many rituals he would like to return to and make new. Months later, Miguel was at the end of his life, and he knew this, and he asked me to bless him. Miguel loved movies, and his room was constantly showing his favorites. I blessed a bag of glitter using words from his saints, Dorothy, Dumbledore, Elle Woods, and Mufasa. Then I sprinkled Miguel with glitter. Miguel's doctor, nurse, and respiratory therapist did the same. We covered him in glitter. A friend that I'll call Jenny hated high school, and with very good reason. She never fit in, and she was taunted relentlessly for it. She was never asked to a dance and was so scared she'd get teased for going that she never went. As Jenny grew up, she never forgot what she felt she missed out on. Jenny went on to create a life that she loved, filled with a loving wife, Amanda, and many friends. When Jenny turned 50, Amanda lined their back patio with candles that spelled out, "Prom?" question mark. "What?" Jenny said when she saw this. Amanda said she loved Jenny and wanted to recreate some of the moments Jenny had missed out on. "I bet I would have loved teenage Jenny, and I want to show you that," Amanda said. So Jenny and Amanda and a big group of their friends dressed in prom attire and went out dancing. Then they went out to dinner in their poofy dresses and brightly colored suits. When Amanda and Jenny got home, Amanda asked Jenny to tell her what she remembered about her 17-year-old self. There are some moments that aren't safe to return to, and that's okay. For the moments we can return to, we can return to the past with love as individuals. We can return to the past with love as a group. Returning doesn't mean fixing. Margaret can't change the accident. Miguel couldn't erase the religious harm he experienced. And Jenny can't take away her high school experience. Returning with love can be simple or complex. It can be an intention, an action, a feeling, a hope. Our intentions, our actions, our feelings, our hoping, our loving, these are beautiful ways to tend to ourselves and to those we love. We cannot change the past, but we can revisit moments of hurt with the compassion of a loving friend from the future. When past pains arise, what tending might you need? I invite you to take a few minutes to think about the parts of your past that pull at you, parts you can return to. Are there moments you have tried to force away but can't? Are there moments you are ashamed of? Are there moments when you long to be cared for? What do you need as you remember these moments? Start with compassion. Sometimes compassion leads to returning to a moment and creating something new. Glitter for me and my classmates, tulle dresses for Jenny. May your hearts and minds be open to opportunities of creation for yourself and for those around you. In one of their newest songs, artist Sam Smith uses a very traditional choral music style that, when I first heard it, transported me to a cathedral. I think about how this style might be reminiscent of the music Miguel would have heard in the church he felt ostracized by. But with this, to me, church-sounding music, Sam and their choir sing an anthem of acceptance, a message that I, and probably Miguel, never could have imagined hearing in the churches of our childhoods. Sam Smith has talked about religious harm they have experienced, and I wonder if this song is their returning to a past of exclusion and creating something new and inclusive. Here are the lyrics. Demons on my shoulder, monsters in my head. Shadow in the water, will you be my friend? The world revolves around me as I lay in my bed, dreaming of more, more. Be yourself so loud tonight, they'll hear you from the stars, sparkling like dynamite, if that is who you are. A hymn for Gloria, Gloria, it's all but a hymn for Gloria. The name Gloria means the glorious one. With your demons, with your monsters, with your shadows, you are glorious. You are worthy. May you be a friend to yourself as you live with your past hurts. May you know that your past deserves tending to. Consider a visit. And as you visit your past, may you gently coat your hurts with glitter. May you bring light to the dark, and may you return with love. Amen.
Thank you.
Thank you, choir. Arlington Street is entirely self-sustaining. It's up to us. And our generosity continues to be astounding. Thank you for your commitment to our staff, our building, and our beloved spiritual community. Each Sunday, we share our collection plate with a partner in our mission of love, service, justice, and peace. This month's beneficiaries are two young people from the Congo, 13-year-old Abigail and 16-year-old Deborah, who are currently in hiding in South Africa. Their legal political asylum status here in the country is assured. Their parents have already made it safely, but they need visas, which may take as much as a year to process. Our own Barbara Seidel is inviting us to partner with her in providing food and moral support for them. More information is available in the order of service or by contacting Barbara through the church office. Thank you for your generosity. Today, I have for you a poem by Emily Dickinson, 1292, Yesterday is History. Predictably, it's very short. I'll read it twice so that we can get twice as much of its meaning. Yesterday is history, 'tis so far away. Yesterday is poetry, 'tis philosophy. Yesterday is mystery, where it is today, while we shrewdly speculate, flutter both away. Yesterday is history, 'tis so far away. Yesterday is poetry, 'tis philosophy. Yesterday is mystery, where it is today, while we shrewdly speculate, flutter both away. Please take a moment now to join me in giving to our beloved spiritual community and supporting all the good work happening in our good name by filling our virtual collection plate. To give online or text your gift, go to ascboston.org. You can also scan the QR code in the order of service or Venmo at Arlington Street. Or you can also mail a check to the church or use the envelopes in the pews, which can be handed to Reverend Alley or to me or to any of our ushers after the service. Thank you for your generosity.
Thank you, Daryl. And now a song by another great Emily, Emily Saliers of the Indigo Girls, who has written so many of the most prophetic lyrics I know over the past few decades. This is one I've been playing for a long time, Closer to Fine, just a beautiful song, one of those ones I keep finding new things to love about when I sing it. If you know some of the words, feel free to sing them along with me as we go. I'm trying to tell you something about my life. Maybe give me insight between black and white. And the best thing you've ever done for me is to help me take my life less seriously. It's only life after all. Well, darkness has a hunger that's insatiable, and lightness has a call that's hard to hear. I wrap my fear around me like a blanket. I sailed my ship of safety till I sank it. I'm crawling on your shores. I went to the doctor, I went to the mountains, I looked to the children, I drank from the fountains. There's more than one answer to these questions, pointing me in a crooked line. And the less I seek my source for some definitive, the closer I am to find. Yeah, the closer I am to find. Yeah, I went to see a doctor. doctor of philosophy, with a poster of Rasputin and a beard down to his knee. And he never did marry or see a B-grade movie. He graded my performance. He said he could see through me. I spent 4 years prostrate to the higher minds. Got my paper and I was free. I went to the doctor, I went to the mountains. I looked to the children, I drank from the fountains. There's more than one answer to these questions. Pointed me in a crooked line. And the less I seek my source for some definitive, the closer I am to find. Yeah, the closer I am to find. Yeah. I stopped by a bar at 3 a.m. to seek solace in a bottle or possibly a friend. And I woke up with a headache, like my head against a board, twice as cloudy as I'd been the night before. And I went in seeking clarity. I went to the doctor, I went to the mountain. I looked to the children, I drank from the fountains. Yeah, we go to the doctor, we go to the mountain. We look to the children, we drank from the fountains. Yeah, we go to the Bible, we go through the workout. We read up on revival, we stand up for the lookout. There's more than one answer to these questions, pointed me in a crooked line. For some definitive, the closer I am to find. Yeah, the closer I am to find. Yeah, the closer I am to find. Yeah.
Thanks, everyone.
Thank you, Mark David and the choir. If you'd like more Arlington Street in your week, please go to ascboston.org. There are weekly gatherings in the Zoom room for loving kindness, meditation, poetry, yoga, and writing. In addition, this Tuesday evening, our governing board, the Prudential Committee, hosts their monthly open meeting, as does our transformation team for racial justice. Every Wednesday at 4 p.m., Reverend Kim and Reverend Beth host a tea party with a conversation prompt. This week's prompt is, what's the strangest gift you've ever received? On Thursday evening, our own John Engstrom reads his poetry at First Church in Cambridge. Congratulations, John. And for those of you in the Boston area who love to sing, come join the choir. Mark David holds rehearsals here at the church on Thursday evenings at 7 p.m. No experience necessary. Looking ahead, Only a Child, our own George Ledger's mission for children who live on the streets in Guatemala, is holding its spring fundraiser 2 weeks from today. You can get your tickets by following the link from Arlington Street's homepage, ascboston.org. You'll also find a link there to Nuns and Fun, an all virtual evening of bingo, raffles, entertainment, and fun, sponsored by Arlington Street and the Sisters of Perpetual Indulgence. Please come, please plan to come. It's going to be a blast. Much more information and Zoom room links are at ascboston.org. To attend any of them, you don't have to be a member, you don't have to turn on your video, or talk if you don't want to, and they're all free. All are always welcome. Following the service, everyone is welcome to join the virtual coffee hour. If you'd like to participate, Please answer yes to the breakout room invitation that will appear on your screen. If you're here in the sanctuary, you'll need to go to the Zoom room before the postlude begins. Thanks to all of you who joined in today's service and to all those who made it possible. Remember, we're all in this together. Our final hymn today is 1028, which can be found in the Teal Hymnal. Let's rise in body, rise in spirit, and sing together 1028.
Before our benediction, I invite those of you in the Zoom room to please reach out your hands and touch the sides of your square, and those of you in the sanctuary to please raise your hands, palms out. Let's send loving kindness to the people to your left and to your right. Send loving kindness to the person on either side of you and to the people on either side of them. Send out love into this beloved spiritual community and feel it coming back to you. Love is the spirit of this congregation. And now for our benediction, I invite you to put your hands over your heart in namaste. I bow to the divine in you. These are the words of Jan Richardson's poem, Blessing in the Chaos. To all that is chaotic in you, let there come silence. Let there be a calming of the clamoring, a stilling of the voices that have laid their claim on you, that have made their home in you, that go with you even to the holy places, but will not let you rest, will not let you hear your life with wholeness or feel the grace that fashioned you. Let what distracts you cease. Let what divides you cease. Let there come an end to what diminishes and demeans, and let depart all that keeps you in its cage. Let there be an opening into the quiet that lies beneath the chaos, where you find the peace you did not think possible and see what shimmers within the storm. Let us keep this faith, beloveds, and pass it on. The service begins when the service ends. Bless your hearts. Amen.
Please visit ascboston.org for more information about this historic Unitarian Universalist congregation. Arlington Street Church, gathered in love and service for justice and peace.